Good afternoon everyone, and welcome to the third of these Composer Insight sessions presented to you by Spitfire Audio. Thank you for all for coming. Really happy to be on the stage here with Hilde Gudnersdottir, and I think that's probably my most tricky job of the night done, saying your name. Forgive me for not giving it a full Icelandic flourish. Would you mind? Was it close enough? Okay, move on. You may have heard Hilda's work through her releases with Touch. You may have heard her on films such as Sicario and The Revenant, and lots of other outlets. You may even have been one of the privileged people to see her as a young girl dressed as a Viking singing in a cave. We'll get on to that. Hilde, thank you for doing this.
My pleasure.
Ready to have your composer insights extracted. you had a classical training, and I'm always interested in talking to people who've had very thorough classical trainings in music, who end up playing music which isn't purely classical. It has lots of different elements to it. Because I think there's a sense in which, when you talk to those people, they say, well, some of it was incredibly useful, the training, and some of it I ended up having to kind of fight against. How was it for you, you know, training as a classical musician and then moving into these very different worlds of music?
Well, I guess it was kind of normal for me, because my whole family are musicians. My father is a conductor and clarinet player, my mother is an opera singer, my uncle is a composer, so music is the most normal thing in my family to do, and so it just seemed normal that a two-year-old would know all the instruments in the symphony orchestra by heart, and you know, I just grew up with that. But it also, I guess, kind of changed the way that I, or not changed, I mean, it's always been like this, but it influenced the way that I experience music a lot, because for me music is it has a lot to do with personalities. So because I grew up with you know, sleeping on the floor of chamber orchestra rehearsals, it was kind of more about the people that were playing than what they were playing, and that's always stayed with me. So the oboe is my aunt, the clarinet is my father, the flute player is this guy called Ben, and you know, so they're all like very specific characters. And it's always been like that. And that's how I've and that's kind of how I work with people. It's more about my personal connection with people than necessarily what we're doing, you know.
Yeah.
And so, but about the classical thing, you know, because my family was, you know, everybody's classical musician, so I obviously it was normal for me to go
in that route, yeah.
Yeah.
Was there a character that you associated the cello with at that time?
Yeah, I guess that's kind of my mom's fault, because she, well, this is what she says at least, but you know, So allegedly, when she was pregnant with me, she knew that this child would be a girl, she would be called Hilde, and she would be a cellist, and you know, so.
It was all written down already.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I think it's because she was listening to Jacqueline Dupré a lot when she was pregnant.
So you didn't have much choice in the matter.
No, not really. And then she was like, yeah, you totally picked it yourself. And I was like, are you sure? Well, I might have, like, you know, pushed it a little bit towards you, but, you know, it ended up staying with me. But I never really liked the cello so much as a kid, because I kind of liked it, but, you know, it's kind of big, and it's kind of a pain in the ass to, you know, when you're 10 years old, and it's rainy and stormy, and, you know, the wind blows the cello, you kind of blow back with it. So it happened to me once that the wind blew the cello, like, took the cello so hard with it, so I, like, fell on the ice, and, like, on the cello and broke it, you know, stuff like this that you have to do when you're 10. But then I started playing in bands when I was like 12, 13, and that became a bigger part of my kind of, well, it was I guess it kind of served my, it was a better outlet for my curiosity, because because I've always been very extremely curious about sound. And
yeah, and you were using the cello at this point in no. the or voice at this point.
Yeah, I was mostly singing and, you know, playing bass or whatever instrument I, you know, was next to me. But never the cello, because the cello was completely, it was a completely different thing. So I never used the cello in any of the bands that I played in.
Right.
But then I think when I was, when I first moved to Berlin and I was studying electroacoustic composition and I spent the whole year just programming. And you guys probably know a lot about that. You know, you can spend the week in front of the computer typing something in and then you get like a beep, you know, after a week.
Yes.
It's incredibly unsatisfying. So I spent the whole year doing that and then I didn't touch the cello and then somehow I just took the cello up again and I was like, oh my God, instant sound. And then I somehow just fell in love with it.
So that was the moment. That was the,
moment, yeah. So it's kind of like, you know, if any one of you are in like a difficult relationship, you know, it's like, it's kind of like you're in a relationship with this, you're married to this guy that you kind of, you don't really like, and you're just kind of, he's just there with it.
This is the guy that your mother told you to marry.
Exactly, your mother kind of like, you know, gives you a hand to this guy and you're stuck with him and then, you know, it's just this wonderful thing and you actually fall in love with him, like 14 years later.
But you have to spend a year.
So you all have hope.
This is only after a year with a computer though, going. Was that something you chose to do, abandon it for the computer, or was it part of your studies? Was it like a test of yourself in some way?
No, I mean, I guess it's like just a part of this incurable curiosity, you know? It's just like you have, I mean, computers are great. I love computers, and I work with, you know, I work with gear a lot, and I work with computers a lot, and I, you know, it's fantastic how, you know, today, it's just like the it's just so easy to do everything by yourself, you know, and it's just like the stuff you can do today compared to when I started, it's just fantastic, you know, and it's I think it's really important to know your way around computers if you want to be speaking as a composer. Here's an insight for you. Yeah. No, I mean, just to be able to record stuff yourself and mix and produce, and I mean, you have to kind of, you know, do that on a computer.
I suppose that thing of the classical training, which we started talking about, it's about the point at which you start to feel that rather than being told how things go, you start making your music. And you start discovering, and that curiosity builds about how sound works and how you want things to sound. Because I think that's quite an important crossover point for people who have a lot of classical training.
I mean, the problem with classical music is that, or like, you know, the problem with studying to be a classical musician is that you're told how things are supposed to be. And when you don't like to be told how things are supposed to be, it doesn't function very well. It doesn't go very well together. But at the same time, you know, it's if you want to get a good grip on an instrument like a cello or a violin or whatever, I mean, you kind of have to have somebody to tell you how things work because it's a whole world of just techniques and things that are really important to learn, I think, from a teacher. And it was really important for me to go through this training because otherwise, you know, I wouldn't be able to play my instrument at all. I mean, you can, of course, do it by yourself, but it's going to take 10 times longer and the results are probably not going to be...
Yeah, there's a lovely quote where you talk about that immediacy of rediscovering the cello and just sort of going, oh wow, you know, I can just immediately make music. And
yeah, exactly. And then of course, like when you know all the rules, then you can break them.
Yeah, you know. Which you certainly do. Yeah. I mean, it's just curious because, you know, I can't really imagine you as a musician happily being told how things should go. That's why I was curious about that.
No, exactly. No, I think curiosity is really my biggest drive. You know, that's kind of why I do music. It's out of curiosity, you know, because I spend a lot of time also building instruments. So I'm working with like three different instrument builders to expand the sound world of the cello. So
One of them has a name, doesn't it? One of your instruments, is it?
Well, two of them have names.
Oh right, they've multiplied since I last looked.
Yeah, and then I have a new one, which still actually doesn't have a name. So.
Which, now, hang on, I'm going to have to look. Which one was it? Was it called, it's not Oscar, is it?
No, Omar.
Omar, yes, yeah. The cello. Tell us a little bit about Omar, your cello.
Yeah, so Omar is, he is, well, he's kind of more like a gamba than a cello. He has six strings and frets. And it's kind of complicated to explain what Omar is. So he's in his smallest form, he's like basically just like the neck and the strings, and I can attach that part to myself so I can move around the space. And then built into Omar is a DSP chip that has an FFT filter in it. So I don't know what people understand about filters, but basically to
there's
so
a
everybody
brain
understands,
there.
There's a brain in there. There's a brain inside Omar. And he's basically simulating another instrument, and so he's simulating. Basically, I can decide which instrument he simulates, and I think this is like it's really a breakthrough in amplified and just like the development of amplified strings, because I mean this is being done with you've been able to do this with software or external hardware, but it's never been built into the instrument itself, and that's really, really something that I think is the future of amplified strings, because you have like no feedback, but also it just sounds really gorgeous. And having spent
Amazing.
The better time of 20 years figuring, you know, trying to find a good amplified string sound, this is like a really huge breakthrough in that, I think. So we're developing. I mean, it's still kind of in the developmental stages, and hopefully, yeah.
But you mentioned that it can play sort of any instrument. Does that mean, is that dependent on the sound files that it's using? Or are you saying that it's, you have a specific cello sound that's been recorded, and then your playing is still triggering the...
Well, it's essentially, for those who want more technical details, it's essentially like an impulse response filter.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
it just depends
on
the impulse that you use, which is... it's basically just like a reverb or whatever.
So theoretically with that, you could use your cello technique to play all sorts of different instruments and sounds.
Yeah.
If you,
Exactly. And then he also has like he has an array of surround chambers, so he has like a body that basically can be in surround. So it's like an electroacoustic surround instrument, which is why he's called Omar, because... we call these in Icelandic to resonate is to Oma, and so that's where the name comes from. It makes more sense in Icelandic, but funny in English.
It's really interesting you talk about these additional sections to the instrument, because I feel that your music is incredibly wedded, if you like, or find space very important. How sound works in a given space seems really important in your music. Would you agree?
Absolutely. It's totally essential. Yeah.
I mean, you're not just playing, you know, there's the space in the cello, but then there's the space in which you're performing, and it seems that your music is always carefully worked for that relationship. I mean, I don't know if you could expand on that a little bit, your feelings on that.
No, I think it's incredibly important. I mean, when you when you're playing a show, it's like music is just like a small. It's really just like a small part of what's happening, actually, because or at least for me, like music is so much about communication. And when you're playing music, you're basically that's what you're doing. You're communicating, and when you're in a concert environment, I think the audience is actually, you know, it's really half of the show is the connection that you have with the audience and how the audience responds to what you're doing, and the space has a huge say in that. I mean, the space is really, it's a gigantic factor in just how the audience feels and how they can, you know, get into the music, and how you can, you know, how you play and therefore like what you give back to the audience, and So I think the more that the space embraces what's happening, that you know, it just enhances everybody's concentration and feeling for what's happening. Yeah.
So I think in a sort of sound check then for you, you may well be testing electronics and certain functional things, but you're also understanding the room and maybe tuning your playing to the room.
Yeah. I try to. Depends on how much time you have, of course, because sometimes you don't have a lot of time.
No, but
I always try to. Yeah.
But there's also, I mean, then there's the physicality in the listener as well, and I know you're very interested in how the body itself is part of that whole resonant process of music making. Is that something you're still looking into? I know that you you do a lot of yoga and there's a connection there for you between the body and the music. I mean, does it frustrate you to see an audience sort of like, you know, in this position for a concert? Do you want them to be more physically able to respond?
Well, I mean, as long as people are comfortable, I don't really care how they are.
Exactly. As long as they're there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. As long as they're there. I mean, I find, for me at least, because my music is very, it's pretty delicate, and it requires a very high level of concentration to be able to really get into it, or like get the most out of it.
Yeah.
And I find if people are standing, that's a little bit harder to get that connection with people. Yeah. So for me, seated audience is always like much preferred, because the standing business is it doesn't really work so well for me.
The focus is changing, maybe, as though.
Yeah, it's just, I don't know, I think people are just better able to concentrate on the music when they're not like thinking about like which foot to kind of, you know, lean on.
yeah, moving out of the way constantly.
Yeah.
I always seem to stand in the place where everyone seems to need to go through to get to the toilet.
Yeah, exactly. And then there's and then there's a bar in the, you know, and then it's just like, doesn't work.
I feel like timbre and the way sounds evolve is hugely important to you, much more so. And obviously there are melodic fragments in a lot of your music, but it's about this really subtle development of tone, isn't it, over time? Is that something that is a real preoccupation for you, much more than, say, any traditional sense of harmony, melody that we might talk about, you know, in that old classical stuff that you trained?
Absolutely. I'm very much of a detail person, so I really like to get lost in the like very fine details of what's happening. I enjoy that the most. If there's just like one sound that I can really concentrate on every single thing that's happening. That's what I enjoy the most. Like when, because I think, you know, I don't know, fast, or I call it like kind of sports music, like when people are like
sports,
you know, when people are like really fast and athletic about their playing. You know, I think it's great for people to be able to do that, but it doesn't really interest me as much as just like really getting lost in those like little timbre noises. You know, it's just, I find.
How do you discover a moment like that makes you think, okay, yes, I've discovered something there, and I want to develop that? Is there an improvisation process that, you know, perhaps when you're starting a new track, how do you lead yourself to that point?
Well, I try not to get stuck with any one method of composing, so I try to just keep everything as open as I can, and but I definitely do have, there's definitely certain ways in for me to kind of get into a state of heightened.
Yeah, it is almost.
You know, heightened awareness or whatever.
State, yeah.
Yeah, kind of. I mean, without wanting to be too pompous about it, but.
No, pomp away. Yeah.
But singing is a huge element for me in that, and my voice plays a really big part in just getting in touch with. what's happening in my body, and then I tune that to what's, you know, what's happening in the room, and then I, you know, maybe move around the space, and the cello also is a way in for me to enter, like,
yeah,
to enter the state.
Yeah.
But also, I mean, I love writing music on, you know, just like when I'm outside walking, or you know, when I'm biking or whatever, you know, it's just, and it's, I mean, that's, I guess that's more, I guess the movement, like if I'm writing something, if I'm walking or biking, it has more to do with melody. So that's somehow, it's like the movement of tones are connected to, like, that I'm actually moving, you know, that I'm physically moving. And then, you know, I'll be singing something or humming something, and it'll just, like, kind of hit me, you know, and then you know if there's something, you know, if there's something in it that you need to carry on, you know. So this one, for example, the main theme of this one film that I'm working on, I wrote it on my bike, and then I recorded it in the first recording of it was recorded in the dairy section of my supermarket, which is now like that. So I was just like,
I could just see that on the IMDb page. Yeah.
See, it's just like, I just try to be open for moments like that, you know, and not exclude anything, you know. There's no better way of writing than any other, but it's just, you know, being open to stepping aside if there's nothing happening, you know. I try not to put myself in a position. Because if I'm trying to force music out of me, that, you know, I can pretty much just forget about it, you know, that it's just better to go out and
walk away.
Yeah. And then you might get hit in the head by another.
Back in the supermarket.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, go back. Do some more grocery shopping. There it is. I mean, given what you're talking about and the importance of spaces and situation and, you know, in your composition, I'd be interested to know more about your studio setup, because I know that there's quite a collaborative setup that you have there in Berlin, isn't it? Can you tell us a bit about your studio, how you've set it up, and how you've made it work well for you? I mean, it's probably got a lot of half-built and as yet unnamed cellos on the floor, is it?
Yeah. I have currently, in my studio, I have 10 cellos.
You need to see a doctor about that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I just realized that the other day. I was like, this is getting a little
10
bit
cellos.
Out of it. Yeah. It's kind of crazy. I should maybe stop.
Are you building some kind of army that's going to sort of take over?
I don't know. It's just like, you know, people keep on, like, you know, doing these beautiful things, and I'm just like, wow, I need to get that. Like, I need to. I'm just like, you know, I can't not support people who are expanding the cello vocabulary. I just have to support that.
Yeah. But this is really fascinating. I mean, you know, just to stay with these 10 cellos for a minute, what different things are being researched and hunted for in these different models? I mean, so you've got Omar, is it? Mm-hmm. Yeah, with the brain and the ability to reproduce whatever. What other kinds of things are you investigating in the instrument?
Well, there's another one that I've been developing with a friend for probably about 10 years, and that's called the Haldorofon.
The
Haldorofon is called Haldor, the guy who built it. And this is like it's amazing. It's such a beast, this instrument. It's absolutely fantastic.
Beast.
So yeah, it's like a feedback machine, basically. So he built this like beautiful body, like, which is almost like a cello body but inverted, and it's really beautiful. Right. And then it has 8 strings, so it has a set of strings on the top, and then a set of 4 resonating strings on the bottom, and then every string has a pickup, and then there's a speaker on the back, so it's like this feedback mechanism.
Oh, wow.
So it's very, I don't know if any one of you were at the Barbican earlier this year, but I played a solo show just with that instrument, with Sonno earlier. And actually I played Omar also with Sonno.
Right.
So I don't know if anyone was.
Amazing.
Yeah. But this is also like, well, the great thing about the Haldorofon is that it truly is like a beast. I mean, there is kind of no way to control it fully, because it's like because it's feedback, and the beautiful thing about feedback is that it is it's so dependent on just like the space, and that's what I love so much about it. Because it's really just like, you know, it changes with a different temperature, or you know, just it's so sensitive that like if you move your little toe, the sound will just like change completely, because it's highly sensitive to any type of movement or change of anything really, you know, or just like you do this like tiny change of a finger, and all of a sudden you get like go like woo, just wah, you know.
Wow.
So it's really
so
fun.
You don't so much
really
play
fun.
It as tame it. You know.
No, it's just, I mean, it's always the same things that are like, that I find so fascinating. It's like when you're playing it, you have to be, like your focus has to be in just 150%, because you just have to be able to respond like to how he responds to you, or how he responds to the room, or you know, how he responds to whatever's his...
It sounds to me like a really, you know, obviously if you're a solo instrumentalist wanting to create the kinds of sounds and worlds of sound that you use, you know, one might turn to looping pedals and all the rest of it, but this sounds like a much more rich and accident prone and interesting way of doubling, tripling yourself, you know, on a stage.
Yeah. I mean, it's really scary also, because they can go like really totally wrong. Like at this Barbican show that I was mentioning, that the night before he totally broke down. And like nothing.
In tears.
No, he broke down in tears. No, that just like the whole electronic part, like the mixer of him just like totally broke down. So I was like contact spraying him the night before, and you know, so I stayed up to like 2 just like spraying him, and so he smelled like shit. It really smelled like oil, you know. So then I started the show, because I thought I'd like totally fixed him. I started the show, and there's like, you know, how many people can, like, are in there, 2,000 people or something.
Yeah.
I walk in.
Relaxing.
Yeah, he's very relaxing. I turn it on, and he just goes like, which was not what he was supposed to be doing. And I was like, why do I do this to myself? Why do I make my life so hard? Yeah, exactly. But then, you know, so it was terrible. It was absolutely horrifying. And I was just like, shit, should I just stop and leave? And then I don't know why I decided to try to hold in the volume knob.
Right.
And that for some reason worked, but I had to play the whole show holding in the volume knob, which was kind of, you know, limiting, because then I had like one hand stuck on the volume knob and I couldn't move it, because then he would, you know, flip out.
It's terrifying.
It's kind of terrifying. Yeah, it's kind of terrifying. But it's also just more fun than knowing, you know. Yeah, knowing exactly what's going to happen. I mean, it's kind of like playing with somebody who's alive, you know, and you just don't control everything, and I just find that kind of a bit more interesting.
There was an avant-garde trombonist called Paul Rutherford, who had a lovely expression for those kinds of situations, but he called it comprovisation, where you were living in some world between composing and improvising. It was somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
And one of the things I love about your music is, because clearly you are very competent with technology, and you know, you had your year where you went beep on the computer, and you use technology, but it I'm never kind of heavily aware of it. The humanity, the cello, and the space that we've been talking about, the timbre, the tiny textural nuances, you manage always to make the machinery kind of subservient somehow.
Oh, great.
It feels to me, anyway, I don't know how, if that is what you aim for, and is
absolutely
that your approach? You know?
Absolutely. It's very much what I aim for, because that's what music is for me. It is, like I was saying before, it is all about communication, and it is all about this personal connection that you have with an instrument, or with a space, or with, you know, that's everything for me, really. So, and machinery, you know, I mean, I think electronics can also, you can have a very specific relationship with electronics, and which can also be great and highly, you can get a lot out of it, but I'm not so interested in music that sounds really electronic, because somehow there's, I just find it less.
Is it something to do with that fragility? not necessarily just fragility, but you know, in human music, things can go wrong, you know, like your beast.
It's absolutely. I mean, I was doing music for like a robot orchestra recently. And that was kind of my main concern was like, okay, how do I turn these robots into humans? You know, how do I make them like non-mechanical?
I mean, this is something that came up actually in the conversation last night. You know, we have this technology that is capable of, over the last decades, of kind of perfecting sound. And now we spend quite a lot of time reintroducing error and distortion and humanity through plugins or whatever. And it's a kind of strange procedure, that, isn't it? Why not keep the humanity there in the first place, you know?
Yeah, exactly. But back to your studio question.
We're in the studio, sometimes.
So I have a studio in Berlin where I live, and I work a lot with my friend Johan Johansson. We've been working together for nearly 20 years or something. So we share a studio together with a friend Dustin O'Halloran also, and some other people. So we're seven people who have like a whole floor in an old factory building, and then each one of us has its own space, and then we have like a few recording spaces also that we.
Oh great! And is there like is there a big live room that you can all share and play, or is it?
No, not really. There's two like smaller live rooms, and then there's like a big hangout room,
right?
Which is more important.
And that leads us nicely into the world of film. So obviously, you know, you tap around on IMDb, we see your name in Sicario and The Revenant. Very distinctive. I mean, you're the DNA, you know, in those opening cues in Sicario is, you know, there's that cello kind of falling sound. Can you talk to us a little bit about how you got involved with that film and how that went for you?
Well, I've been involved in almost every project that Johan has done since we met, or with the exception of maybe two films that I didn't do so much in. So it's kind of, we're kind of like musical siblings or husband and wife or whatever. So we basically are involved in one way or the other in almost every project that the other does. So that was just a logical step. But The Revenant, so all the cello that you hear in The Revenant is played by me, and that was just it just happened because Ryuji liked my music the director, he really liked my music, so they tamped apparently a lot of the film with my music, and then he wanted to get me involved.
I mean, you know, it doesn't take a huge feat of imagination to understand why your music is so usable in a film situation, you know, and because of these long timbral kind of journeys, and none of the sports music that you talked about. Is that something you want to do more and more of, working in film and scoring, creating your own scores?
I mean, I've been doing a lot of that, so I just scored, I've done five scores within 1 year now, so it's kind of safe to say that I've been doing a lot of film scores recently.
We are there.
So I just scored the sequel to Sicario, which is called Soldado. So that's coming out next year, and I scored that by myself. And then we are finishing now the score for a film called Mary Magdalene that I'm doing together with Johan, and so it's like a shared composer film. We were just recording last weekend at Air.
Yeah,
with some of the people who are playing later, also playing later.
For the gig tonight.
Some of them are playing in our score. So that's a really, really, really beautiful film. And so basically my whole year has just been scores.
I mean, you know, if you're used to some of the luxuries we've talked about of, being in this amazing room with 10 robot cellos and dreaming up scores in a supermarket, film is a big machine, a big strange collaborative machine, or can be. How there must be frustrations in there as well as joys. I mean, how have you found, you know, the language of music needs translating for all these execs or whatever? Has that been an interesting journey for you?
Yeah, I mean, it can be tough. It's really, and the bigger the films get, I mean, both Soldado and Mari Mertelin, they're pretty big Hollywood films, and I really feel, you know, you really feel the difference of the pressure, like, you know, the bigger the films get, because there's just, you know, people are putting more money into them, and you know, so there's a bigger risk, and you know, people want to get their money back, and you know, so it's a lot of...
Well, I'm thinking of something you said only a few minutes ago, you know, if a composition's not happening, don't force it. And sometimes in a film situation, that won't be an option.
No, exactly. You have to, but you still have to, well, I mean, at least I try to find the middle path between that, because it's still, there's a whole lot of opinions in big films like these. And, you know, there's a lot of people have a pretty loud voice and have a lot of say in what happens, especially with the music, because the music comes in latest. So it's kind of, you know, if there's something that doesn't work in the edit or the you know, the way it's filmed or whatever, it's sometimes kind of up to the music to lift things up or drag, you know. So it's a lot of, there's often a lot of pressure on music. And normally we don't have a lot of time either to work. So it's, you know, it's time sensitive. It's, it's pretty stressful.
Right.
But it's also, I mean, it's also fun, but it's, what was I going to say? Yeah, I mean, like for Soldado, for example, I mean, we wrote, like I wrote like 13 hours of music you know, and ended up being like 100 in the film, and then cut down to, you know, so it's a whole process, and there's a whole, because the composer is always like the most, he's the most likely to get fired, basically, because he's just replaced in the shortest amount of time. So, it's kind of this high pressure of like, okay, you have to deliver this, or basically you're going to get fired. So you kind of just have to produce.
I think somebody said last night, you know, you're only a film composer once you've been fired. You know,
You
can only call yourself.
Exactly. So I still haven't. So this is just. So maybe I'm not a film composer after all.
Yeah. a good moment to say, if anyone has any questions they want to ask, please do just stick your hand up. We don't need to kind of wait till the end. If there's anything you want to ask, holler. Otherwise, we'll carry on. The voice is often, even if not obviously present in your recordings, it's something you still refer back to. And I'm struck by how, even though, you know, you were there struggling with a cello as a kid, you know, being blown over in the wind, once you've fallen in love with the cello, I'm struck by the similarities of, you know, the human shape, the cavity that resonates with the voice and the cello. Are they very connected for you in that way?
Yes, absolutely. It's almost, the cello and the voice are for me almost the same thing. And you're right, there's a lot of hidden voice in my recordings, because I think the voice can really lift up the timbre of the cello. And when you're, I don't know if there's any cellos in the room, but like when you're playing, then you really feel the resonance of the instrument on your chest. So you really physically feel it, and basically when you're singing, you can really. What I do a lot is that I kind of try to blend the voice into the cello. So it's basically one. It's like one instrument, basically. And for me, that is, you know, it's all the same. It's all the same thing, basically.
That's interesting, yeah. And afraid that does lead me on to the Viking outfit and the cave.
Mm. Yeah.
So what was that about? Were you dressed as a Viking was it for tourists?
Mm-hmm.
And what were you singing?
Well, it was my first job. So I used to be my first job was as a child Viking, and a
my first
child
job
Viking.
As a child Viking.
Yes, exactly. So basically, my mom, who was a singer, she had this job as a singer in this Viking restaurant in Hafnarfjörður, where I grew up. It's, I don't know if you've been to Iceland, but there's like, yeah, it's a whole Viking thing in that town, and especially this one restaurant is very like full on Viking. And so basically, the owner had this great idea for the Christmas buffet that we would have like a singing child Viking, and me being the daughter of the grown up singing Viking, it was like just a logical thing.
It's a natural
choice. Yeah, exactly. To have me doing that. So the Christmas buffet was like my high season, and so I would dress up in like this green Viking costume with a Christmas hat and a candle. And then I would just, you know, come in singing these Christmas songs, solo Christmas songs. And I was I might have been like 9 when I started doing that. So I did that for a few years. And then as I got a little bit older, so I was maybe like 12, I kind of got a promotion. And then I was allowed to go on hijack buses of tourists on the way from the airport. So we would go, so Hafnarfjörður is basically on the way, like between Keflavík and Reykjavík, there's this little town. And so I would go with a flock of Vikings who were like fully armored. But it was all like, you know, it was all pre-designed obviously, but we would stop certain buses, and then we would like, you know, come barging in and take them to a take them to this public park where I would sing for them in a cave. And then I would feed them shark.
Feed them shark?
Yes.
Excellent. I love drawing a line between that and you on stage at the Barbican fighting with a robot cello. I mean,
yeah, right.
You know, there's a life
the
in music.
The eternal fight. Like, where's my sword when that whole thing was going?
I just want to ask about, I want to return to this, because I know it's something that you're passionate about, this idea of space mm-hmm. and music, and how you think about that when you record an album. Because, you know, obviously people can listen to albums in all kinds of different places and spaces, or have it directly, you know, played into their brain through the headphones. How do you consider space when you're recording, and when you think about how the listener will consume your recordings?
Mm-hmm. Well, space is also very important for me when I record, and basically when you... Well, I kind of always see like when you release a record, it's kind of like putting a message in a bottle. So you're communicating with somebody in the future that you don't know who is, and you don't know what they're gonna, where they're gonna be, or what they're gonna hear, or what they're gonna take from what you're saying to them. But I think when people listen to music, they're creating a space also.
That's a personal space, a kind of psychic space, or
yeah. I mean, yeah. You put on. I mean, you really. I mean, music is very manipulative, and basically, when you put on certain music, then you're putting on a certain. You're creating a space for a certain situation.
Yeah.
You know,
it's
like, are you? You know, do you feel relaxed? Do you want to be? Do you want to be excited, or do you want to? So you basically. Basically, music can really control that, and it can also like really be a companionship. Mm-hmm. I think it can really keep you company just to listen to something, and with that, you really do create a space.
Yeah.
And so I think the space that you record music in is also like very important for that. And I try to be, very specific for specific pieces. Like where I record them and how.
So within an album, there may well be different locations that have been used for the different.
Well, it's different between albums. I mean, one of my albums, for example, was recorded in York, and that was recorded live in surround. So it was like a whole. Basically, I just recorded in one take, and that was. There was like I recorded with speakers in the room in surround, and it was recorded in surround. So it was, but I recorded like it was the 42nd take or something that I was like, okay, this was it, you know. So
wow. Okay.
You know,
blimey.
Yeah. But that was, you know, that was a very kind of space specific record, and it was pretty much only about the space. And yeah. I'm sorry. The nice thing about this record, for example, you know, just mentioning how, you know, what people take from what you're saying. It was a record called Leðurljósinu, and it means allow the light, basically. So it's all about, you know, light perception. This record.
Yeah.
And there was this guy who was doing some research on was doing a doctorate or something is it called like photosynthesis? Plants, you know, need light to grow. And he was kind of stuck with, he couldn't crack what was happening with something with the photosynthesis. And he just like listened to this record on repeat, and then all of a sudden like boom, it just came. And then basically he got it through the music. Yeah. And I of course have no idea about photosynthesis, you know, but
right.
it's just like this beautiful, example of this type of communication that you have no idea what you're like, you know, what a person is going to perceive.
And
that's what I love about releasing music, you know, it's this kind of unknown communication.
Let me just see if anyone wants to ask anything. Come on, don't be shy. Anybody, a gentleman here? Yep. Did everyone hear that? The question was, would you ever consider collaborating with Spitfire and creating, what was your expression?
A signature
solo album. Yeah, sample library.
I don't think so. Because to be completely honest, because it is something that's, you know, it is very specific to me. And also, I mean, I have been creating, like different libraries just for myself, or well, for the guys in the studio also. So there's like a Hildutron that's like that's
yeah.
like circulating in our studio, and all of a sudden this Hildutron is like on everybody's project.
There it is again.
But yeah,
yeah.
You're like, you know.
Yeah.
But it's also, I think, because we have been discussing this. And this has come up before, and I think the way that I play is—it's so connected to specific things that I'm not sure doing a library of me would really translate. You know, so.
It's a really interesting question. Yeah, the idea of, you know, it makes me think of how, you know, when photography was first born, people felt their souls might be captured, you know, by the camera. I think it's an interesting question for a musician. Would you allow some essence of yourself out there for everyone to sort of play around with? You know?
It's not even just that the essence of myself that I'm concerned about. It's more, it's just like the way that. Well, I'm really crap with samples anyway. I can't make them sound good. So I'm probably not the best person. I mean, there's genius people at working with samples, but I'm kind of like amateur when it comes to that. But I think that you know, there's a level of reaction that's hard to translate to samples.
Do you mean by that the kind of reaction you will have for a given random moment, you know, a bit like you were saying, playing with a robot, you have to respond.
Yeah.
And so the sampling process, even though a give and take might be interesting, it won't have that that changeable reaction.
Yeah. Well, I think it's also because, I don't know, I guess also because the solo cello thing is really, personal and very reactive to how I am feeling that certain day, or the temperature of where, like the climate of where I am, or whatever, you know, the room that I'm in. So, but I think, so that's just for me always like very sensitive.
I mean, this is a question that comes up so much, more and more so, I think, talking to anyone who uses computers and music, is how we somehow allow ourselves to create given infinite possibility, because infinite possibility is ultimately just totally paralyzing. I don't know, in your year of working with a computer going beep, whether, you know, what thoughts you had about how computers are used in music making in that way. Because we, as I say, it's staggering what can now just sit on a laptop, which you would have required rooms to do, you know, a few decades ago.
I think you just have to, I mean, it's really easy to get lost because, you know, there's so many possibilities. But you, I think it just, if you're just clear about what you want to do and what you want to achieve, then you can go for that, you know. Like this, you know, like the impulse response filter in the cello. I mean, it's very clear what the purpose is, and then it's easier to go for it. But if you're just...
So if you know where you're trying to sail, you can stay the course.
It just makes it easier to go anywhere. Even though it's also just like fun to spend, you know, days just like trying stuff out, you know, it's also important, you know.
Yeah,
but in
yeah.
the end, in the end, I guess it's just a matter of just like knowing what you want.
Yeah, I read something you said, a lovely quote from you about how, you know, there's a suspicion when people are playing with laptops that all they're doing is their tax return or their emails.
Mm-hmm.
And when you rediscover the cello, it's like, yeah, no emails on this, not
yeah.
yet. Yeah. But you don't. But I'm starting to think that maybe one of your cellos lying around on the studio floor does do email. It's going to be, you know, this is worrying me.
I'm seriously going to have to train one of them to do emails
first
because
Wi-Fi.
My emails are very behind. There's some people here who know all about that.
Yeah. anyone else want to ask anything before we sort of... Yeah. That's the ultimate question, actually. Yeah, where's it all coming from? I mean, and the question's about, you know, landscape and partly and a particular kind of sound that seems to be part of perhaps Berlin and Iceland.
Well, I think that your environment has a huge say in what kind of music you make, and the climate probably more than anything else, because. I feel for myself, at least, if I'm working in a place that's too warm, it just like, you know, it just shuts me down. So I can't really function very well where it's really, really warm. So Berlin is gonna, I mean, it actually can get very warm there in the summer, which can be problematic. But Berlin is the similarities. I mean, it's Iceland has a lot of space, you know. So you always have the horizon, and you always have the sea, and you always have mountains, which is great because it just opens things up a lot because you have so much space. And Berlin, similarly, it also kind of has a lot of space, but not like landscape-wise, really. Because, I mean, it's a big city, so. It has more like personal space basically because you know London is very you don't have a lot of space in London. People are pretty like in your face all the time, and you don't have a lot of elbow space. But in Berlin, you can go unnoticed pretty easily for a very long time, and you always kind of have freedom to move. And Berlin is kind of also. It can be a bit grey, so it can be a bit depressing also.
Did you use the word melancholy? I can't remember. Yeah, I think that I was interested in that word coming up and whether you felt there was melancholy written through in some of this material in any deliberate way.
Well, people use that word a lot. But for me, it's not like my music is not melancholic. Like for me, like that's not what I get from it. I mean, for me, it's more. For me, it's more about focus and concentration, and that's kind of, you know, the state. This is kind of what comes out of that state, basically. Yeah. But it's not like, you know, I'm not like crying and writing this music. It's more just like being like very concentrated. That brings me into this state, because also, I guess, like, you know, on a day-to-day basis, I'm pretty outgoing and laughing and you know, people.
Yeah, you're not exactly exuding
that. No, exactly. People have a really hard time to believe that this is me who's doing this music. But I guess it's like, you know, this counterbalance of being a very kind of, you know, joking, outgoing person.
Yeah,
and then there's this flip side where, you know, that stuff just comes out.
I wonder if there's a sense in which once you get below the surface reading of it, perhaps harmonically feeling melancholy, in the detail, that tiny detail that you talk quite a lot about is where the melancholy is lost, and it's more about just this investigation, a fairly joyous investigation of timbre.
Yeah, I mean, I find it joyous. I love it. It's like
your own music.
I love it so much. You know, because it's just, it's so magical. It's like so, and I, after all these years of working in this way, I'm still totally just, you know, obsessed, and I still love it so much, you know, so it's
which is a lovely point to hear. Well, we should close shortly, but does anyone else have any queries? I just want to, was there one there? No.
Susan.
I wanted to ask you just, oh, sorry, beg your pardon. Go ahead.
I know you mostly through Boom, mm-hmm. and I was wondering where that is now and what you're working on.
Yes, absolutely. So Moom is like, I've been playing with Moom since I was 14 years old. Or I used to play with them before the band became Moom. And so I really, really grew up with them, and they're really like my family. And it was a totally different space of music creation, because Moom was very much about just, you know, like we grew up, we just basically, there wasn't any internet, it was really hard to get away from Iceland, and so basically we just did music to have fun, you know, so we would just hang out and do music. And we're still very much like that, and I actually hijacked Gunni from Moom, I hijacked him to Berlin, because he's working with me on all the films and everything that I'm doing now, so basically he is one of the only persons that I meet. Like, I pretty much spent like 24 hours a day with him, so we're very much in contact still, and we're still in the family. But I think Moom is still active. You know, we're still playing, even though I took a bit of a break because I was just focusing on my stuff. But I really, really enjoy playing with Moom also. I mean, it just gives me so much, and it's also, you know, when you grow up with people in music, then you get to this level where you don't need to use words. You know, you can just you can be on stage and you do like a twitch or you know, move your shoulder, and they'd be like, aha, got it. And then, you know, it's so much fun. It's really lovely.
I mean, it's interesting that you know we're talking about Moom and the sheer joy of collaboration and togetherness of that, and then reflecting on how I think your first album with Touch, if I'm not mistaken, was a very deliberate attempt to kind of be only yourself, you know. And it's obviously important for you to keep those two like poles going, you know, the band experience as well as this solo exploration.
Yeah. No, for me it's really important because it's like a completely different space that you enter. Yeah. When you're collaborating and when you're just hanging out by yourself, and I think it's really important to do both for me.
Can't spend all your time with the robots.
Yeah, exactly.
Anyone else? Yeah.
Even if you use
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Did everyone sort of get that? I'll just do a very brief praisey. We were talking and agreeing about the kind of paralyzing fear of infinite possibilities on a computer, et cetera, et cetera. And the question was really about how you find limitation within that, because that's freeing in the end. So what? How do you construct those limitations?
I think for me, it has the most to do with how you go enter the music, you know, because or enter whatever you're trying to do. And for me, like I was saying, I enter that through my voice or through a cello and also through drawing. So there's a lot of music that I write specifically if I'm working for other people, like if I'm writing for ensembles or orchestras or a bigger group of people, then somehow I very often access that through drawing. And it's just about finding the right way in, and then you find the limitations somehow. And it's, I think, and that's kind of just the hardest, and also just to allow that to be what it is, you know, and to accept yourself and the limitations you have and live with them. So I don't know if that answers your question, but somehow I find that this helps me to find the path, basically, is to find the right way in.
You wouldn't call them self-imposed or somehow self-imposed roots?
Self-imposed what, sorry?
You wouldn't call them like roots, self-imposed roots.
Roots?
Yeah, rules.
Roots.
You wouldn't call them
roots.
Self-imposed
roots.
Rules.
Well, I try not to have rules. But at the same time, I mean, you're totally right. You have to have rules also, but somehow it really just depends, because like I try to do, because I'm just so curious and all over the place, I try to do everything, you know, so I'm, you know, I have to play everything, I have to record everything, I have to arrange everything, I have to, you know, I don't have a manager, I'm just like, I don't know, booking agent, you know, so it's a big mess, and
it's a big mess.
I also have people who can agree on
make
that.
A big mess, then somebody clears it up.
Yeah, exactly. No, you try to clear it up yourself. And what was my point again? Exactly, it's already a mess. But it also depends on what you're, you know, if you're working for if you're writing music for a robot ensemble, the robots are your limitations. Like if you're working with a symphony orchestra, that's your limitation also. But I find the tricky thing is just the way in, and then the limitations become clear somehow.
It's almost like saying, don't open too many doors at once, just open one and go in that way and pursue that, you know?
Yeah, and also just like, I don't know, just being, accepting what the, what I mean, it's just, I guess it's because I'm just so, I always think I can do everything by myself, and I think I can work with every given method, but at the same time, I know that I create the best things when I'm honest about who I am and what my methods and ways are. And it's just like, you know, it's just being honest with yourself. That kind of, that's the most tricky thing. And just like accepting like, okay, maybe this is not the way for me to write, even though it would be great if I could write like this, but maybe that's not me.
Yeah. Sadly, we have to leave it there, but hopefully we can carry on these conversations in the bar about being honest to ourselves and robots and the rest. Thank you so much, Hilda. It's been fantastic.
Cool.
Thanks, everyone.